four heavens. It's going to shift. Again, it's a parallel shift. So if we think of this much income change, we have to have the same rise in future incomes. We get an increase in income that distance. Where will consumption go up to? Those are not exactly the same distance, because you have to draw this diagram very carefully if you want to get the marginal principle consumed. We actually won. But unlike the previous picture, where there was a big difference between the rise in income and the rise in consumption, here you generally expect for reasonable indifference curves that the rise in consumption is of a similar size to the rise in income. That's the change in consumption. Income, they're of a similar size. If you draw a problem. So that's why this Fisher model has an advantage over the Keynesian theory. Keynesian theory of consumption. Theory of consumption would basically give you a consumption function that looks like the cross-section. That line of best fit I put through the cross-section, that's very close to the type of consumption function you assume for the Keynesian model. However, it will be inconsistent with the time signals. The Fisher model, on the other hand, is consistent with both to the extent that it's reasonable to think of time series is having permanent changes in income, and the cross-section is having mainly temporary changes in income. That's the famous Kuznets consumption puzzle, that's what it's called. You can read about it in the textbooks and the subject guide as well. That's the sort of intellectual history as to how this theory of consumption was developed. It was developed to explain the puzzle that the time series works one way, the cross-section works another way. You needed a theory that would be consistent. Both. Okay, let's take a break. We resume at 10 past 10.
But did he say this was important? He says it's important. question, they just don't understand. So I think any way to do it is I think we're even.
Thank you. Phil's the one to see that.
Okay, so before we go on, just a correction to the last, very last diagram I drew. It wasn't just my poor skills at illustration. I'm actually measuring, as someone pointed out, the change in income from the wrong point to the wrong point. So the correct way to do it, of course, is not the horizontal shift of the budget line. It's the horizontal distance between one income point and the next income point. This is the diagram where it's perfect, where consumption and income are changing both by exactly the same amount as it is a permanent increase. The mistake before was I was taking it as that distance, which is wrong. Make sense? Basically, this is the correct change in income, not that. But I basically drew the delta y to be larger than it was in that example. That's why it was so hard to get them to look like they were the same. That's why it was so hard to get them to look like they were the same that distance. We should move on to a new topic and question. So let's look at the question number 10. So this is on aggregate demand and aggregate supply with an application to the liquidity trap and the inflation. Okay, so first part. First part is fairly easy. So, using the ISLM model, show how the aggregate demand curve is derived. That's an aggregate demand equation. Price level, real income. So why is the aggregate demand curve downward sloping? So in microeconomics, why are demand curves downward sloping? It's an easy question, but it's worth asking yourself that question when you start to think about the aggregate demand curve. Yeah, so the demand function is a negative relationship. Why does that negative relationship exist? Why, if the price of a smartphone goes down, will people buy more of it? Because it's got cheaper relative to other goods. In micro, that's basically what you say is the reason for why demand curves are downward sloping. There's substitution towards goods that are cheaper and away from goods that are more expensive. Can you say the same for aggregate demand? So if P goes down, have goods got cheaper? Well, they have relative to money, but that's more complicated. That's not so people consume money. So the problem with just taking what you know about microeconomics and blindly applying it to the aggregate demand curve is that P is the price of all goods. It's the average over all goods. So when P goes down, you can't say any particular good has got cheaper or more expensive relative to any other good. So you can't apply your intuition from microeconomics to the aggregate demand curve. Basically because P is the general price level. It's not the price of a specific good, it's the price on average of all goods. So how do we obtain the aggregate demand function?